5 panelists, 5 topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they will manage.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, you know, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when yes. things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
Well, what I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.
More democracy or less, the debate that our future hinges on. A debate that has recently captured the Nigerian public's imagination, especially in light of my Rwandan adventure late last year, is, does democracy serve a developing Africa well, or is so-called benevolent dictatorship the way forward for us? Do we do it the Botswana way, or do we do it the Rwanda way? Do we have sustainable progress via consensus, or quick progress via military fiat? I always make the point that post-independence African dictators, whether perceived as benevolent or otherwise, all fail to achieve the goals that dictatorship is supposedly optimized for, all of them without an exception. Whether it was Thomas Sankara or Mobutu Sese Seko, dictatorship really has no spectrum of good to evil because it always results in the same things. And these things are disregard for rule of law, intolerance of political opposition, development of a personality cult, and eventually, inevitably, the dreaded corruption. Now, Mobutu, Idi Amin, and Mengistu of Ethiopia might have specialized in open villainhood. Everyone knew that these are bad guys. But the thing is, even the supposed good ones like Thomas Sankara also ended up misusing their power and oppressing people. So in Sankara's case, he favored setting up show trials where the defendants were not allowed legal representation, and they were hit with unreasonable punishments, including ludicrously long prison terms and fines. Now, conveniently, his political enemies tended to end up on the wrong side of these things, and that's funny, huh? The regular counterpoint to this is, well, we've had democracy since 1999, and you know, what has it done for us? And to this, I have one clear and simple response, and that is what we Nigerians have known as democracy since 1999 is only democracy in the most general sense of the word. The first civilian president in the Fourth Republic was General Olusegun Obasanjo, well, retired general, if that makes you feel better. The next was the brother of Shehu Yar'Adua, another prominent military figure. The third was a rank outsider who was quickly booted out when the empire struck back in 2015. And the fourth, well, we all know him very well, don't we? The actors are almost exclusively derived of the military era, and the apparatus of state is still configured toward military dictatorship. If you don't get the scale of Nigeria's sheer lack of any kind of democratic tradition, consider that Nigeria only passed a Freedom of Information Act under a non-military affiliated president within the last decade for the first time in its history. In other words, the point I'm making is that the problems Nigerians have with the current political system are the result of dictatorship, not democracy. The reaction to the perceived failures of civilian administration to get the results we want to see should not be to hanker after the military jackboots that hamstrung their civilian successors in the first place. I wrote recently about General Murtala Mohammed's unilateral gutting of the civil service in 1976, which effectively destroyed the country's central institution by removing its knowledge bank and instituting a grab-all-you-can ad hoc culture. The results of that boneheaded dictatorial decision still live with us today under what is, at least in name, a civilian administration. So our dissatisfaction with these problems should not impel us to go back to our proverbial Egypt, craving for a strong man to come and sort everything out in his strong, unilateral, unquestioned, process-free, and unaccountable wisdom. I mean, this would seem to be a basic point of logic and common sense from my point of view, but unfortunately it seems as if the penny really has not dropped with a significant number of Nigerians, and indeed, Africans. In case the point I'm trying to make is not clear enough, I will reiterate in plain English. The solution to the problems associated with democracy as we know it is more democracy. Dictatorship is never the answer, except the question is, do you want to go back in time and die of toxic nostalgia? It is not easy to accept the annoyances and responsibilities that come with democracy, but life is never easy, and Africans of all people should know that.
I really appreciate your history lesson, because some of these people, like Sankara, I hadn't actually come across until I came across your script. So, but I do know Idi Amin, because we watched the horror. There was a movie version. And
Idi Amin was a bad guy.
Heads in fridges.
Sankara was also
no, but they made a movie about Idi Amin. Heads in, yeah, because actually, when I read up Sankara after that, you could see that the guy bothered to set out a vision. Mm-hmm. He would write things about women's rights. Mm-hmm. He would write things about how he saw nation.
And he actually achieved a few things.
But so the, really, the crux of the matter is the guy derailed, not because he didn't set out with an intention to be a good man, but because, again, no checks and balances, which I have to weigh into the same scale as you. Dictatorship cannot work for anybody, whether in the Western world or in Africa or wherever. Once you leave one man without any checks and balances, it's a recipe for disaster. He will eventually abuse it. Even if he doesn't do it initially, as time passes, he will abuse it. So you have to respect people like Nelson Mandela for just setting a limit on their own time, because they don't want to become toxic, and people around them will not tell them.
He operated, Nelson Mandela. Yeah, he wasn't a dictator.
No, but he determined that he wouldn't do second term. And that was the safest thing to do. So I think, you know, going back to your rivers of wickedness, we need to also be aware when we look at people who are operating without checks and balances, whether in our homes or in our offices or wherever, that is where the danger lies. A bit like Emeka is trying to target incompetence. I will take a step behind that and say, where you can put checks and balances, put checks and balances.
Because, Emeka, please, permit me to quickly do this. In agreement with you completely, if we had allowed democracy, no matter as faulty as it was in the First Republic, as faulty as it was, if we had allowed it to thrive, like you said, the best way out of the problem of democracy is more democracy.
Or the right kind of
democracy. Right, no, because if we had allowed it, we probably would have fumbled, wombled, and stumbled. By now, you will have a system in place that would have grown out of those problems.
Mistake.
But at every point, we run back to our proverbia, to use your word, Egypt. Okay. And then we go back, you bring a military, supposedly military benevolent person who ends up, you know, becoming a dictator. Like Dari.
But were we not secretly Dari dreaming Babarisa that our present president will operate like a dictator and just
No.
Make
that's
it easy
for some
for us.
People. That's for some people, not for some of us. Mm. Dari Babarisa once wrote an article, he said, knowing when to die. That some of these dictators knew when to die. If Murtala Mohammed had not died when he died, he probably would have been worse than the worst dictator we've ever had. Mm. You talked about the issue of some PAMSEC said they were on their way to work when they heard their name on radio, sacked. And so that introduced psychophancy, warming up to a federal commissioner. You know, before then, a PAMSEC could disagree openly with a governor, a federal commissioner, because that wasn't his true. But when he knew that he could be sacked over the radio, he would have to koto. So this was how we gradually destroyed all of the institution. And now you begin to look for one Jerry Rawlings who will come and right the wrong.
Yes.
No. We need to consistently continue on this trajectory to get it right. Mm. And if we're in a military dictator, you and I will be in this dictatorship.
Doing a program like
no matter how benevolent, you and I will be in this studio discussing. It's impossible.
Yeah.
And so with all its faults, democracy is still the best
way
for
to
us,
go.
And we still need to just
fine-tune
trudge
it.
On and fine-tune it as we go.
Emeka,
I completely agree with David, with liberals, with what you guys have said.
What of me? You're not agreeing with me, Emeka.
Yeah, I agree with you as well. But let me say this though.
It's not presumed though.
Let me drop a little caveat. And the point is this, and we've seen it. Democracy can also lead to a dictatorship. Let's just get that. We
yes,
saw what
I agree
happened
with you.
In Germany, that led to after the First World War, and with Hitler's the rise of the Third Reich. So it is possible for people to manipulate a democratic government into a dictatorship, and that can happen. So I think the most important thing is that it's the values of democracy that we need to work a lot more on in terms of getting the citizens to participate and understand that, you know, because again, the other point that, before I come back to this is that understanding that development is one thing, because you can also develop as a country under a system of government that is not democratic. So let's also understand that.
Yeah, we saw that in
China,
Nigeria.
Because China, you know, I just want to separate the two, because people often say, like David said when he started his advocacy, that people who make the thing that, look, we've operated under democracy since 1999. Where has that gotten us? Mm. So that is we need to sort of
distinguish
two things. Yeah, distinguish them. Yes, under democracy, it's a thing about your humanity is given a voice. You're able to. It's not often perfect. Democracy is really it's how humanity functions. People have a voice.
Yeah.
If you even if in this situation where on a domestic level you're a parent, you're a father, and you operate in the most autocratic, despotic own home environment.
Yes.
Trust me.
No matter how much.
But sorry,
no
Mecca, let me come in very quickly because I want you to continue.
That, no matter how much development you bring to that home, no matter how much toys or buildings or you know you bring to that, when there is no humanity in that home, it's not the same.
And just taking from when you said, you know, democracy is giving a voice to humanity, I feel that we also, again, back to my theme of taking responsibility, maybe that's my lockdown motto. I feel that a lot of times when people are comfortable and we have to take responsibility ourselves as the middle class or upper class, however we see ourselves, people seem to be able to just divorce themselves from the pains of others.
Yeah.
How can we be happy in a country where there's so much illiteracy, there's so much poverty? The voice of others, especially the ones who are disenfranchised, should bother us day and night. And that's why the chickens are coming home to roost. If we're in a country where the majority of the population are not enlightened thinkers, that's why a few people are able to oppress the majority. So we should make it our priority, those of us who have access to education, access to whatever it is we have, to we will not be happy until others join us. So then you have a majority voice who will not stand for the rubbish that's
which is why David is raising this advocacy. You know, it's a voice.
Hmm.
It's a way of educating people. You know the extent,
but
the mileage this one will go.
We can't be passive. Those of us who have managed to put generator in our house,
with you.
Jeep in our...
I agree with you. So that's why also Emeka is saying, let's distinguish between what democracy is really about.
Yeah.
Not about the development,
the,
not about building roads.
The voice of the many. Yeah.
It is about humanity. Because you can build these roads, you can put all the best structures in place, and yet the people are not free. There is no humanity being lifted up.
Yeah.
So it's all about fear. It's you know. So we need to really understand what democracy is about.
Yeah.
And so once we understand it, we can preach the message of democracy.
And not be happy
it's
that
a voice.
You have your own voice.
Yes.
What about the others?
So want to
my last word that I'll just
Have to be your last.
I'll just point out that. So people often point to China as the example of the country that developed without democracy and supposedly doing fantastically well. And I'll also I just want to say that if there's a Canadian city called Vancouver, which recently introduced a tax on empty houses because their real estate market was being distorted by wealthy Chinese people coming in and buying up their real estate. Now, there are so many Chinese people coming from China and parking their money in Canada that city had to enact that legislation. Why are they doing that? They're doing that because no matter how much economic growth is happening in China, no matter how much money they're making, no matter how many roads and high-speed roads they're building, they are not free.
Yeah.
So they're trying to escape to where
they send their children to Canada. Their children become
school.
Canadian citizens
yeah.
and settle down there. You know, and then the parents are back home.
Under a democratic
Shanghai,
system.
Whatever. Exactly.
Yes.
So democracy is the gold standard of the human condition.
Democracy is about asking questions. When your leaders go wrong, you point it to them that this, you challenge them, yes. You challenge them that this is not the way to go about it. It's about voice, about humanity.
Let me add that, because we mentioned China, we mentioned all of these Western countries, and people tend to think that democracy is Western. But I'm an Igbo man, and one of the things of being an Igbo person is this is a fundamental democracy that in Igbos that we have. So it's not, I want to put it in perspective because it's not, so when people say, that's why the Igbos say, Igbo enweze, the Igbos have no king.
I don't even think it's limited to the Igbos. I think it's a human thing.
No, I have to use an example that I'm comfortable, that I understand. Yeah.
So that was my first outing on The Advocate, and already it feels like home. No wonder it's all about our Commonwealth. Keep your comments coming in on Facebook at Plus TV Africa. Hashtag The Advocate NG on Twitter and Instagram at Plus TV Africa and hashtag The Advocate NG. To catch up with previous broadcasts, go to plustvafrica.com/The Advocate. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Plus TV Africa. Until next time, when the topics
will be fresh but familiar. Let's keep advocating for a better society. Goodbye.
Bye-bye. Five panelists, five topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they will manage.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
What I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.